Welcome, Hope Grown Faith, to another episode of our Monday Mom Mentor, where we are equipped and encouraged to nurture the hope of Christ in our homes. And today we have with us, for probably the third or fourth time, yay, Tara L. Cole. Welcome, Tara.
Hi, I'm glad to be here.
So for those of you who don't know Tara, who don't know you, would you tell us a little bit about you and your ministry?
All right, my name is Tara L. Cole. I am a wife, boy mom with three boys, ages 14 to 9. I had to think there for a second. They're in 8th, 7th, and 4th grade for the next 11 days. And then I also teach at a state university here in Oklahoma. And I have a podcast, Over a Cup, and I'm an author of a few books. Everyday Prayers for the School Year is the most recent. So that's pretty much me. And I teach writing, so my life revolves around words and writing.
And writing, which is so good. And she's also not only good at writing, but also at speaking. So that is like a good double whammy.
Well, thank you.
All right. So we've been talking about this recently, and I know that you've been researching the Holy Spirit for about 5 years or so. So tell us, what got you started on this path of wanting to know more about the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity? You'd think we'd know a lot about him, and yet it seems like we kind of often forget about him. So what got you started on that?
Well, like many of you, I grew up in a church that kind of acknowledged his presence, but because of the way some people like really take off with the Holy Spirit in some of their ministries, and you're not sure if it's him or just extra theatrical stuff, then our church kind of avoided the Holy Spirit. He was, yes, he's there, but then that was all that was ever said about him. We didn't learn about him in Bible school until like recently, probably. And it's funny how God does this. Like, as I was starting to think, hey, I need to learn more about the Holy Spirit, then classes popped up at church for it. So that's kind of a God thing, where just as I was thinking, okay, I need to learn more about this, then my church started having a class on it here or there, which is not something they typically do. That's rather new to our church. And so I realized what really did it was I realized we had this freedom in Christ, but I was still exhausted as a mom. And I was like, you tell me I have this power, but why do I feel like I have this power? Like, we are told in Ephesians that the same power that raised Christ Jesus from the dead lives in us. And I'm like, well, that's great and all, but I don't feel like it. And is that power like reserved for evangelists that are doing big things over in Africa? Because, you know, God, I really need your help on Monday mornings. And so that's really where I started researching it, because it didn't sound like the Holy Spirit was just for big evangelists off doing big things in other countries. It sounded like he was for all of us, but I didn't see his working or anything like that, or sure didn't feel like it, except for those God instances behind the scenes. And so that's what really got me on track of studying the Holy Spirit and wanting to know more about this third person that got, Jesus told us in John, it's good that I go away because I'm sending the Holy Spirit. And I was like, well, if Jesus says it's good, it must be, but I don't see it. So that's kind of what got me started.
Interesting. It's actually like an act of the Holy Spirit that he was working in your heart at the same time he was working in the hearts of somebody at your church.
Yeah.
Like, you know, we should offer a class on this at the very same time that you were thinking about this. Like, that is one of the things the Holy Spirit does. It's like,
yes,
seed those moments.
Yes.
That's pretty cool. I love
it. It is pretty cool.
Timing of that. So tell us then, who's the Holy Spirit? Let's have some teaching by Tara.
All right. So he is the third person of the Godhead, like we all are familiar with. He was there at the beginning, starting in Genesis 1, verse 2. He was the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters, even from the beginning. So a lot of times we think of him as part of an Acts thing. After Jesus left, here comes the Holy Spirit. But no, the whole Trinity, all of God was present even at the creation of the world. Because we know God the Creator was, he spoke everything into being. The Holy Spirit was hovering over the waters even before God spoke light there. So a lot of times he's attributed with bringing calm out of chaos. Because a lot of times when he shows up, his presence in different places and giving powers, he's bringing calm out of chaos. And we know Jesus was there because at the beginning of John, it says the word became flesh and dwelt among us, and everything was created by him and for him. John chapter one. And so they were all three present at creation. They all have different jobs. One of my friends kind of says like they're like an intertwined rope. So they're all God. They're a part of God. You need all three of them, but it's kind of like an intertwined rope. They loop around each other. And so we see him present throughout the entire Old Testament because he fills people with his spirit from time to time. Samson was filled with the spirit and was given strength. Others were given gifts of skill. Like if you read in Exodus about the building of the tabernacle, there were some that were given these skills to administrate the building and then to weave and all these things. So there's many times throughout the Old Testament where the Spirit of God comes upon somebody and gives them power for a purpose. But then unlike us, the Spirit doesn't usually indwell them for a lifetime. David's a little bit different. He seemed to have the Spirit of God over his life. We know that there was a time when the Spirit of God left Saul, and David even came and played the harp for him and calmed Saul. So David's one of the few that he seemed to dwell with longer than most, but usually it was for power was given for a purpose. And then when that purpose was served, the spirit came off of them or no longer was with them or indwelt them in that way. Whereas in the New Testament, it tells us Jesus is promising the Holy Spirit in his Passover talk right there before his crucifixion. And so he tells us again, he'll counsel you, he'll guide you, he'll remind you of what I have taught you. So he gives all these things, gives these three characteristics of the Spirit in that talk, and then tells the apostles to wait until he comes on them in power in Acts 2. And from that time on, we find out when Peter ends that with Acts 2:38, believe and repent of your sins and be baptized, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Then after that, he's indwelling them from that time forward when they become Christians. So I thought, all right, this Old Testament Spirit obviously had power. We can see it in the apostles because they were hiding up until the Holy Spirit came on them.
Yeah.
Like Jesus found them hiding twice, at least in the upper room. A week after he rose from the dead, he found them hiding. And then a week later, Thomas saw them and they were still hiding with the doors locked. And then he found them fishing. One of the last times he saw them, they were just back out at their job fishing because they went back to what they knew. It wasn't until the Holy Spirit came on them on the day of Pentecost, where once again, they were up in the upper room, sort of, we don't know if they're hiding out in that moment with the doors locked, but they were still all together. But after that Holy Spirit came on them and they went out and started talking, their lives were completely changed after that. They're no longer scared and behind locked doors. Instead, they are out spreading the message. So there was a definite before and after the Holy Spirit in their lives that we can see.
I would often think of the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament as coming like on someone. That seems to be the mm-hmm. language that is used, like on outside, like I've got mm-hmm. you for this job and then I'm not going to be on you anymore. Mm-hmm. Whereas in the New Testament, after the flame comes on, then goes in them and mm-hmm. resides in them and stays in them.
Because it even says we're the temple of the Holy Spirit.
Right.
So yeah. God's presence is in us just like it was in the temple back in the Old Testament.
Which I was thinking like, so there's so much more that Jesus did when he died on the cross and he rose. And we talk often about those things and his salvation and through forgiveness of sins. And yet it's actually like his ascension, because he ascended and the Holy Spirit came, that really empowers us to be different from the people in the Old Testament. It's mm-hmm. so it's that the crucifixion, the resurrection, and the ascension. mm-hmm. They're all critical, because if Jesus had just stuck around, he said, it's actually for your benefit that I leave, because then the Holy Spirit can come and be with all of you instead of just like me, one guy. Mm-hmm. We can't all talk at the same time. So what would you say are like some characteristics of the Holy Spirit that we really need to remember in our daily lives?
Well, as you start looking through your Bible, they'll leap off the page at you. But as moms, especially, I need like his strength. Is one, because so often we feel so weak and under-equipped for what we're called to do. We often need his counsel, wisdom to know what to do in different circumstances, because for hundreds of years, the world stayed pretty much the same. I mean, there were changes, but not life-altering changes. You could tell your kids, do this, don't do that, and they'd be good. But in the last 100 years since the Industrial Revolution, and now in the last 25 years since the Technology Revolution, things are changing so fast. We have to give our kids principles, not rules necessarily, because my rule that's good today may be completely wrong tomorrow or no longer fit the situation. Or irrelevant.
Yeah.
Yes. And so it can be really hard to give them rules, hard and fast rules, because they change so fast. And there's new technology out that wasn't out 2 seconds ago. And now they're encountering it in situations I didn't even know they were encountering it in. Yeah. And so you simply can't keep up. And so we need his counsel and his wisdom. I'm constantly asking for things like that. So those are the things the moms need the most. We also need to know that he's our assurance of our inheritance. So no matter how badly you feel like you screwed up today, you have the Holy Spirit in you guaranteeing your inheritance. And if your kids are Christians, guaranteeing their inheritance into eternal life. So the end of the story is written, no matter how the middle goes. It is written. If you're a Christian and your kids are Christian, you have that confidence that no matter what today looks like, you can have that confidence. So really his strength, counsel, and confidence are three that really stick out to me as a mom. And the funny thing is that I saw this, let me bring up my notes real quick. One verse that really sticks out to me, it's worded a little bit differently in Matthew, but in Luke it says, if you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? And that's Luke 11:13. And so it occurred to me as I was studying that, like, God will not force his love on you. He loves you, the end, but he will not force you to accept his love. Jesus offers salvation. He will not throw you in the water or make you pray a prayer or anything. He will not force you to become a Christian. He's not going to do it. The Holy Spirit is there. And like you and I talked about at the beginning, we see him interacting. Like when I was wanting to study the Holy Spirit, he was working in my heart and he worked in the hearts of our church leaders to start hosting that class. But he won't work actively in your life if you don't want him to. I liken it to driving a car. So all of us have our favorite cars. Mine's a 98 Corvette, or 68 Corvette is my favorite dream car one of these days. But what I liken the Holy Spirit to is like, God is giving you this car. It's his love for you. He's giving you your very favorite car that you could ever have. And like, he gives all of us his love. When you become a Christian, your destination is heaven, the end. You know where you're going. But the Holy Spirit is like the gas tank in your car. You can stick your feet through the floorboard like Fred Flintstone and pedal your way all the way to heaven under your own strength if you want to, or you can just ask the Holy Spirit for his power and for his help in these situations and surrender and lean into him and push that button on the dashboard or turn the key, whichever type of car you have, and go in his strength. He will not force you to use his strength, but he's always there waiting for you to use his strength. So just like the other two members of the Godhead, he's not going to force himself on us, but he's always there waiting for us to ask. God had this good gift, but he's not going to force us to open it.
Ah, that is such a good visual. I never thought of that before. I want to show my kids the Flintstones now so that that will make sense to them. Yes. You know, God is so good that he doesn't force us. Sometimes I'm like, could you just use a little force sometimes? But that's when we get things like the flood. So, or, you know, Jonah running away from God and God sending this big massive storm again to force him to come back toward them. So we don't really love it when God uses force, but sometimes I think, come on, God.
Yes, please.
You're just so gentle. I appreciate God's gentleness. I do. I don't want a big storm to chase me down. I do appreciate how his kindness draws me to repentance. And I loved what you were saying about that assurance of salvation and that confidence. I didn't think I'd really thought about that before, but that is so true. And I am so glad, Holy Spirit, that you do that for us. So why do we underestimate the Holy Spirit? When I asked inside the group, like, what would you say to God about the Holy Spirit? What would you ask God about the Holy Spirit? Somebody said, God, how do you feel about us continuously underestimating your Holy Spirit all the time and just completely ignoring you? Why do we do that? Why do we underestimate?
I think it's because we're scared of him. Because I remember being in a class and somebody talking about the Holy Spirit. And I was like, that's great now, but I feel like I'm getting ready to get on the roller coaster. Because life in the Spirit is surprising. He doesn't always go by our schedules or our timetables. He may have he talks to us in different ways. I'll qualify it that way. He speaks to our hearts and speaks to all of us in different ways. You can be assured that he's never going to contradict the Bible. So what you hear in your heart, what you hear from outside, if it contradicts the Bible, you're not probably not hearing correctly. Because Jesus tells us in John 10 that my sheep follow me because they hear my voice. He tells us in John 15 and 16, when he's talking about the Holy Spirit, he will remind you of the things I have said. So yes, the Holy Spirit, I firmly believe, speaks to us in our hearts, drops thoughts in our heads, things like that, pounds on our doors of our hearts. But if he contradicts what Jesus is saying, you need to, he's not going to, because he reminds us of what Jesus has said. And those things, he does not make up new scripture for you or something like that. And so that's important to remember, is the Godhead does not contradict each other or argue with each other. They're all speaking the same language. But like recently, this prayer breakfast for church would not leave my head for months. I've been like, God, you know, 5 people showed up when I did it by myself last time. Like, this was not a roaring success or anything. This is not, I understand a prayer breakfast, back school breakfast is a really good idea, but it kind of sort of failed. And he would not leave me alone. So finally, like, I just kept coming to mind. It kept floating to my heart. It kept coming over and over and over again. And so when something like that happens, I think there's one of 2 responses we can do. We can be like Moses and be like, yes, but have you thought this, 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 and this? I'm an awful speaker. I can't do this. And actually, Moses flat out told him no. And this is why. So we can say yes, but, or we can put our reasons there and say only 5 people showed up. I'm not a good event planner, but yes. It's all in the way you put those 2 words. Do you do yes, but, or but yes? And so when I said, but yes, then it came to mind, okay, we'll talk to this person at church. And I talked to that person at church, and it led to this and that and the other. And this morning, right before this, I just had a meeting with our women's minister and our church minister, and we made a plan, and it's happening in August.
Okay.
And yes, so it's on the calendar, and it's happening. And we'll
and
see
what God
does.
And you're not doing it alone.
No, and I'm not doing it alone, because I said, God, you know I think of event planning and marketing and graphics. These are not my gifts. You have seen those, and they are really awful whenever I do them by myself. So yes, he's provided and opened the doors for those parts to be taken care of. And I get to be organized and be a leader and just talk and pray, which is where my gifting lie, and not with decorating or menus or any of that stuff.
Wow.
So we'll see what God does with it. But a lot of times you'll feel something like that coming up again and again and again. But I had to be willing to surrender to him and say yes. Other time, and you can tell him no. I've told him no before. And it's almost like you can feel this, when you tell your kids no.
Yeah.
And then I'm like, why did, and this, I'll say no because I'm scared or something like that. Or I'll say, God, I hear you, but that is really scary. Or things like that. Sometimes you'll hear something in a sermon that really pricks your heart, but you have to be willing to ask him. So when I have a problem with a sin, I'll say, God, I really need your help in this. And he likes to help, but it might be uncomfortable. Or when I'm with my kids, God, I really need your strength today. I just can't. And he gives me enough strength to make it through that day. Or when our kids are fighting or there's a situation, God, I need your wisdom. And he'll have ideas that pop into our head that we didn't haven't thought about in years. So many times I've read a book, and then after I pray that prayer, before I walk into a room where my kids are fighting, an idea will float to mind that I read in the book years ago, but I know it wasn't top of mind then. And so that's how he answers my prayers. And I pray for his help. God, I need your spirit here now. I need your help here today in my home. I don't know what to do. I know you have the wisdom, and he empowers me in that way. Am I Samson ripping stones apart? No.
That's okay. You need your house.
Yeah. Not today. But the work he does on my heart and my home I think is just as miraculous as anything like that. And he can still work miraculous things. I'm not saying he can't. I'm just saying it has not happened to where I've seen like a huge miraculous thing in my life per se. But the way he gives me strength for each day, the way he gives me wisdom, I've even had where I've just prayed. And then one of my friends told me this, that I think it was her mom, was praying that if she or any of her kids had a problem, that they would get caught, that they're doing something they should not be doing, that God would help them get caught. And so I've even just had a random twinge that I needed to check on my son in his room for something. And I went in there and he was on a device and one thing led to another and he needed caught. And so I was like, thank you, Spirit, for just giving me that thought that, hey, I probably need to pay attention here. And so that's how he speaks to me in my heart. Some friends have like a special symbol that he sends them to show him he cares, like a rainbow or a bird or something like that is the way he speaks to that kid. Just like we talk to all our kids differently. I find he does the same in his kids' lives. But again, whatever he's telling you, if it doesn't line up with the Bible, it's not truth. That's an important thing to remember there.
So I was just going to go back to why you think we underestimate the Holy Spirit so often. It is because maybe we want to, because we're afraid. I liked what you said about that. It reminds me of a conversation that I had with one of my kids recently. And he was like, well, what if God asked me to do this? I'm like, I don't think that God asks you to do something. Like, he leads us gently, right? Like when I felt very clearly that God was asking me to donate a kidney. But I didn't, it wasn't like, no, we don't want to do that. It was scary, but there was something inside me that was like, oh, I want to do this. Or like when I started getting up early on Wednesdays to go to the 6:30 in the morning prayer meeting, which is very, very unlike me. I felt the night before the first time I went, like, I want to do this. Like, wow, God is making me want to do this. And now he's calling me to do it. So, okay, I guess I'm going to go. And I've happily gone for like the last 2.5 months.
And you're not the first person I've heard. Our church's preacher's wife a few years ago, she also had that pull from God to donate a kidney. And she waited a year before he showed her who to donate it to. And it was somebody she didn't even know needed one. That was another member at our church. And like the likelihood of them being a connection between this man who needed one yesterday because his brother's kidney was failing that had been transplanted years ago.
Wow.
And hers matching were like a bazillion to one. And yes, you're not the first person I've heard that God has said, you need to donate a kidney.
My point is, like, sometimes we hear these stories and we're like, oh my goodness, I don't want God to ask me to do something. That sounds really scary. And yet it gives us the courage in the moment. And he will usually also give us the desire. There's a verse in Philippians that says he gives us the desire and the ability to follow him. So he's not going to drag us kicking and screaming into something. He's going to move us to do something, but we're probably also going to kind of want to do that by that point.
Sometimes we do. Sometimes I have resisted for months.
Yeah. Yes. Oh, no, for sure. I've 100% resisted things too. But I think that we don't need to be afraid.
In my spirit when I'm resisting, it's like a war's going on in my spirit. Yeah. And as soon as I say yes, it's like, whoosh.
Yeah. It always, I know, I gotta remind myself, it's always better to just obey. I never regret obeying.
Yeah. And usually, I mean, it's not bad things or like you said, it's not crazy things. And sometimes like this prayer breakfast or other stuff he's called me to, I feel way under equipped. I'm like, what in the world are you thinking? But when I say, but yes, with all my excuses before the but and the yes afterwards, he opens the doors. He makes a way. And like you said, it's gently and it's often in ways I don't expect at all. But it works out.
You know what, that your but yes and yes but are like the big difference between Zechariah and Mary and how they responded to the angel Gabriel. I always wondered, like, Mary also says, like, hello, I'm a virgin, how's this gonna happen? She also has some questions, but she says but yes, whereas Zechariah goes yes but. So that is the difference in the way that the
response. I had not thought about that, but yeah, I think you're right.
I only thought about it because you had put it out there, so Well, I loved how you said that. The yes, but the but yes, that's great. So how can we, do you have some tips for how we ourselves or how we could help our kids live in the power of the Holy Spirit on a day-to-day basis? Like you're talking about, does it just come down to remembering to pray?
I think a couple things. One is you have to be in the Word, because one of the first things Jesus tells them when he's promising them in John 16 is that he will remind you of the things I have taught you. So if you haven't studied his word or put it in your heart, it's going to be a whole lot harder for him to remind you of stuff that you don't even know. So you need to hang out with Jesus, even if that's a verse a day, a verse a week. I know you have lots of studies here in Hope Grown Faith to get them started. I see your fruitful book behind you, but you have to do something to get yourself and your kids in the word. Even if it's just a toehold, God can do a lot with your little. He can do a lot with the toe hold or 5 minutes, but get yourself into his word. Because it's even called the sword of the spirit. We talk about, you have an armor of God study, and you talk about the sword of the spirit. That's the word of God. So the spirit and the word of God are connected several times, that if you're not in the word, you're not holding your sword. You don't know how to use it. And the spirit can't remind you of what you haven't even heard yet. Then it's important to ask. God says, I will give him to those who ask for him. So yes, whenever you're struggling, remember to ask for help. Because like I said, he's not going to force his way in there on you. A lot of times we ask for good help and to study well and to all this stuff. But asking for his help in our day to day is so very important, to just remember to say, I'm open to where you're going to take me. Please just help me in this situation. Give me wisdom to know which path to take. Sometimes there's waiting and sitting in that. Like when I think it's Habakkuk is talking. Yes, I think it's Habakkuk and not Hezekiah. When he says, I'm going to wait for you on the ramparts and see what God will answer me. Sometimes there's some waiting in that. Right now, I feel like he's asking me to do something. I'm like, what? And I'm kind of wondering. And so I mentioned it to my husband last night. And I said, will you pray about this with me? Because it was one of those things where in Bible class that felt like he had a big red blinking arrow pointing at me.
Oh, yeah.
But there's like a 3-month timeline. So I said, okay, I'm going to put this over here and pray about it. I'm not going to let it consume my thoughts, but I'm listening. I'm willing to see what you want me to do with this. And I'm listening and we'll see. But it's not like he's asking me to turn the whole train around tomorrow. But sometimes we have to wait. We feel like he's asking us to do something, but we don't know the details or what should happen. And we just sit in the waiting and say, okay, yes. And then wait to see what he does next. Sometimes when I've prayed, like for friends for my kids, as I mentioned in the book, Everyday Prayers, that took a 5-year period before anything happened. And it took a work of the spirit in my heart, because about 9 months of those, he was saying, I want you to leave this church, not because the people were awful, not for anything to do with it. And I want you to go over here. And I said, send us anywhere but there. They don't need us. It wasn't because I didn't like the church. I just felt like they didn't need us. Mm-hmm. Little did I know how much our family needed them.
Oh.
And that's where we are right now, is they're a really big church. I really didn't think they needed us. Our family needed them. And as soon as I said yes to what this conflict that was going on in my heart for like 9 months, my kids had the friends I had been praying for 5 years.
Wow.
And so sometimes, I mean, we are waiting on him, but sometimes he's waiting on us to say yes when he's giving us those. And that's what the conflict I was talking about that was in me that was like, ugh, a few minutes ago, or was that he was asking us to leave, but I was like, man, I don't want to. But I kind of felt our roots loosening for several years. It wasn't a shocking thing. I felt our roots loosening. Friends were moving away and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I just wasn't ready to let go. But then COVID cut everything off.
God sent COVID just to get you out of that church. Just kidding. Woo!
But I mean, sometimes he's building stuff up in us. Mm-hmm. Yes, he used it for good in our lives.
Yeah, that's incredible. Okay, well, Tara, I feel like I could talk with you for a very long time about this, but we should probably also wrap it up. So tell me, just for those who don't know, where they can find you online, and then we'll wrap her up.
TaraLCole.com. You can connect to all the things there.
Make super it nice and easy. Well, thank you so much for sharing a bit of your journey and the things that you've learned. I just love how some of it I was like, yeah, I know this stuff. But then there was a few things that you said where the Holy Spirit was, you know, like, remember this, Christy, remember this. So, or, you know, you would say something in a different way. And I just love how God works like that. So thank you so much for coming today. Thanks for taking the time.
Thank you for having me.